Hey, yeah, sorry about being gone for the last month. Anyway, let's just jump right into it. Today we're talking about Flames of War. This is the third edition of the game, being probably the best edition of the game easily because, well, Battlefront does have a tendency to learn from their mistakes. So, for those of you who aren't super familiar, Flames of War is a 15mm World War II miniatures game made by Battlefront, a company located out of New Zealand. And really, there's not much more to it than that. It's not like other games where I can go into the fluff because it's a historical game. So, yeah, you kind of already know what you're getting. So, like I said, this is the third edition of the rules. This is the mini rulebook you get out of the starter boxes. It doesn't come spiral bound like this, but this literally cost me $5 to get done at FedEx Kinko's. So, one of the best things about this book is that everything in it is in beautiful, lavish, full color. It's all very nicely done and everything looks really cool. And all these diagrams and all these little pictures here are actually showing you how to play the game, and it's really helpful. It's helped me learn the game a lot, and I actually haven't even sat down and played a real game of it yet. Now, at its core, Flames of War is a pretty simplistic game. It's not super complicated. There's some kind of touchy bits, but overall, it's a pretty easy system to learn. But it's far from perfect. It does have its problems. For starters, they use a phase system, and I've mentioned time and time again that I don't like the phase system. I was willing to chalk it up to it being a 15mm game and thinking, I can't think of any other game in that scale that uses that sort of massive army sort of deal going on that really doesn't do that. And then I realized Drop Zone Commander doesn't, and they should really learn from Drop Zone Commander on that one. It also lacks things like a reaction mechanic, so the I go, you go system can get a little tedious. From what I've seen, it's not nearly as bad as, say, 40K, where if somebody's playing Orcs or Tyranids, you might as well just go make a sandwich while your opponent's taking their turn, because it's going to take them an hour just to move everything. So, one of the cool features of the game is that they actually managed to break World War II up into three different periods. You have early war, mid war, and late war, with early war kind of getting the shaft because, yeah, everything in it kind of sucks because Battlefront hasn't really touched it for a while. Because everybody's really big into late war, because that's when all the cool new toys were out. And, well, I play a mid-war army. So, mid-war is strangely probably the most balanced of the three, but everybody wants to play late war because, again, all the big shiny new toys. So you might be thinking, it's a World War II game. I know exactly what armies you can play. You can play Japan, United States, Britain, Germany, and Russia, right? Five armies. Well, actually, you'd be wrong. First of all, Japan doesn't have an army in this game. There is no Pacific theater for Flames of War. It's all Europe and North Africa because, well, let's face it, the Pacific theater infantry battles just wouldn't be all that exciting to play. Yeah, the naval and air battles would be really cool, but infantry battles, it's just beach landing after beach landing after beach landing. And really, let's face facts, all those beach landings were just to secure more airfields. So that eliminates one army. But you'd be wrong, there are not just the big four. There are a bunch of different armies. You can play as Greeks, you can play as Italians, which is what I play. You can play as French in early and late war. You can play as Romanians, Hungarians. You could play as Finland, for God's sake. So, as I mentioned before, this game has a lot of really neat concepts going for it. There's all sorts of things. It's not just tanks and infantry. There's cavalry in the game because that was a thing. There's also air support, and one of the cool things is artillery, and it's actually handled really well in the way that you can do artillery bombardments. So, army building in this game, if you've ever played Warhammer 40K, it's very similar to that and it'd be very familiar to you. You have a command section, which is usually just two command teams, your company commander and a second in command, and then you have two platoons you have to take compulsory. Sometimes you have three. For example, the company I'm running, the compulsory choices are a command team, a rifle platoon, another rifle platoon, and a machine gun platoon. So I have to take four things mandatory, but then you can go from there and pick all sorts of different stuff to fill how you please. So instead of having individual army books like other games do, this just has a bunch of campaign books. This is the North Africa book, which is the book where the Italians show up the most, so it's what I use. So to give you an idea of what I was talking about in here, each of these four spots that's a darker shade that's blacked out or whatever. Those are compulsory choices. You have to take those. And then everyone in gray is an optional choice. So you get a lot of choices of how you want to build your platoons and companies. So, for example, you could take armor and you have three different choices of what you can take. This one's a little complicated because, you know, there's Sicily and Tunisia, and certain ones can only be taken in combination with other ones. But it gives you a good idea of how the army lists are laid out. So these books are really cool. They're really fantastic. They all have multiple armies in them. This one, for example, has Germany, Italy, the United States, and the United Kingdom. And it has a whole bunch of different sub-armies for the United Kingdom, like New Zealand, and I think there's Indians in here, and Irish Guard, and the Scottish Guard, and Canadians. So it's everybody that participated in the fighting in North Africa is represented in this book. So that's Flames of War. If you're looking for a solid World War II game and you like 15mm scale, this is definitely a good choice. You can pick up the mini rulebook either in one of the starter boxes, or you can find many of them on eBay, which is where I got mine. You can find some that are already spiral bound. If not, again, $5 to get it done, and it got done very well. So, hope you enjoyed it. Sorry I've been gone for a month. I'm going to start churning out some more stuff rather soon.